Good morning on this Lord's Day. I invite you to turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 13. We're looking at verses 1 through 23. We continue our journey through the Gospel of Matthew, such a practical book. It's just as relevant today as it was when the pen was first written on the parchment. A young couple once went to the movies and they took their three-month-old baby along with them. Evidently, they couldn't find a babysitter. And while they were sitting in the theater waiting for the show to begin, an usher approached them with this warning. He said, "I'm sorry, but if the baby cries, you'll have to leave, but we will give you your money back." Well, after watching the movie for about a half an hour, the husband turned to his wife and he said, "Honey, how do you like the movie?" She turned to him and quietly whispered, "I hate it. It's rotten." He replied, "I think so too. Pinch the baby." Well, that's obviously not the way to solve a problem. And my hope is that nobody watching this video will be pinching any babies. But seriously, thank you for tuning in to our Sunday morning message here each week. Just like you, I would much rather be meeting together physically every Sunday as a family, a church family, with the warm fellowship and the corporate worship of what it means to be a church. Meanwhile, let me just strongly encourage you to spend some of your downtime digging into God's Word, really listening to His voice, spending time in intentional prayer and growing deeper in your walk with God during this season. Someone once said that love is spelled T-I-M-E. In other words, if you love somebody, you're going to spend time with them. And we're called to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so let me encourage you to spend time this season, this down season for many of us, to spend more time with Him. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank You for Your Word. We pray that You would speak to our hearts. Help us, Father, to see the things we need to understand and apply to our lives to be more and more the kind of people You've called us to be. Father, we thank You for the relationship that we have with You. We pray that You would speak to our hearts through Your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning, again, we continue in the Gospel of Matthew. We're looking in chapter 13, and we're dealing with the parable of the sower and the seed. And if you missed last week, that was part one. I would invite you, if you missed it, to go back and watch part one before you continue here. But let me just give you a quick review of what we've covered so far. Jesus here in our passage tells a parable. Now, a parable is a story about people like you, people like me. And in fact, I pointed out this last time, and that is the fact that a parable is a lot like a mirror and also a window. It's like a mirror in that a parable really helps us to see ourselves, exposing us for maybe who we really are. And a parable is also like a window. It helps us see through to the reality of life and who God really is and our relationship with Him. And so in our journey of faith, my hope, my prayer is that we will be able to identify and recognize ourselves better as followers of Jesus Christ, called to grow in our faith and knowledge about who He really is. Well, in the parable of the sower and the seed, we discover the fact that there are basically four kinds of people in the world today. Basically four different responses, four different kinds of soil that respond to God's truth. And you see, the kind of person you are when it comes to how you respond to the truth of God's word really makes all the difference in the world. Why? Because as Jesus points out here in our passage, it affects our destiny. It affects this life and also the life to come. Well, let's take another look at this familiar passage here, beginning in verse 1. It says, "On that day, Jesus went out of the house and was sitting by the sea. And great multitudes gathered to him, so that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole multitude was standing on the beach. And he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, 'Behold, the sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell beside the road, and the birds came and ate them up. Others fell upon rocky places, where they did not have much soil. And immediately they sprang up, because they had no depth of soil. But when the sun had risen, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And others fell among the thorns, and the thorns came up and choked them out. And others fell on the good soil and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. He who has ears, let him hear." Let me quickly review the background about this parable. First of all, we have the sower, and we pointed out last time that the sower sowing seed, that was a very common practice in the first century. The sower, or we might call him the farmer, would put around his shoulder a bag of seed, and then he would go out into his field and walk back and forth up and down across his field. And as he walked, he would reach into his bag and he would take a handful of seed and he would toss it, kind of fling it out anywhere and everywhere, all around him. And the wind would blow that seed throughout the field. And sometimes the seed would actually blow outside of the field. And so the seed would land on all kinds, all types, all different kinds of soil. And that's the picture that we have here. Now, the sower in this parable represents the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to notice in verse 3, it doesn't say a sower went out to sow. It says the sower went out to sow. The sower is Jesus Christ himself. He's the one who is spreading the word of God's truth in the world today, primarily doing the work of a sower, of a farmer. How's he doing that? How is Jesus spreading the truth, the seed of God's truth in the world today? How's he doing that? Well, he's using his disciples. That's you and me, as his hands and as his feet. In other words, he's working in and through each and every one of us. And so in a very real sense, we all as disciples are sowers. Okay, so what about the field? Well, the field in the parable, as Jesus points out here, is the world. It is the whole world. Now, what about the seed? The seed is the truth of God's word. In fact, the basic job description that we have here as sowers of his seed is spelled out for us in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Jesus said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." And so as sowers of his seed, we are called to spread it anywhere and everywhere throughout the world. In fact, the seed of the gospel has been sown in this world now for the last 2,000 years. So when's the harvest? Well, the harvest, as we pointed out last time, is the judgment day. It's spelled out for us in the book of Revelation, chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. And it's at this judgment where unbelievers from all the ages down throughout history are finally all gathered together before the very throne of God and judged for their sins and consigned to a Christless eternity. It's a horrific picture of what we have here in Revelation 20 of the final judgment. And that's the final harvest at the very end of time itself. Meanwhile, each of us has a corner of the field in this world in which to sow seeds. In fact, we are all under God's command to sow, to plant seed wherever we find ourselves and whatever the opportunity, in the workplace, in the community, with our family, with our friends, with acquaintances, with whoever we meet. We are called to do the work of a farmer, sowing or planting the seed of God's truth. So what we have described here in this chapter, chapter 13, are four different kinds of soil, four different kinds of people, four different kinds of hearts that we find in the world today. What are the four kinds of soil? Well, we looked at the first one last week. Jesus points out that the seed that fell beside the road, which the birds gobbled up, represents the soil of the hard heart. What kind of person is this? Well, we know people like this. This is the person who basically does not want to hear nor accept the gospel. This is the person who hears the good news, but nothing really penetrates the heart. And so there's no root here. It's obvious that this person is lost. Why? Because the heart is so hard. It is too hard. These are the people with closed minds. They're the ones with unteachable spirits. They are indifferent to what you say. What you say goes in one ear and out the other. This person says, I should point out, Jesus says, hears the word. This person hears the word of the kingdom, but does not understand it. And there might be a lot of different reasons for that. It might be because of their pride or fear or prejudice or immoral character or any number of different reasons, but the bottom line is an unwillingness to deal with sin. We know people like this. They don't want to repent. They don't want to change. Someone once put it this way: sin hardens the heart, and the heart that is hardened sins all the more. In other words, their condition worsens. Romans chapter 1, we looked at this last week, describes in graphic detail the downward spiral of sinful choices and the hardening of the heart that results. And so this is a very dangerous, a very deadly place to be. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 7 warns this kind of person. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. We talked a few weeks ago about how the human heart can eventually be hardened, basically to the point of no return. Individuals who, by repeated rejection of the gospel, time and time and time again, eventually become so hopelessly unable to respond to the ministry of the Holy Spirit of God. We call that, or the Bible calls that, the unpardonable sin. We looked at that in the last chapter, chapter 12. And the principle really is summed up for us in Proverbs 29, verse 1, that warns that a man who hardens his neck after much reproof will suddenly be broken beyond remedy. There's a second kind of soil that we looked at last week, and it's the shallow heart. It represents the shallow heart. In verse 20, Jesus says, "And the one on whom seed was sown on the rocky places, this is the man who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no firm root in himself, but is only temporary. And when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he falls away." Again, we know people like this. You know people like this. They're the impulsive ones. This is the person who actually enjoys hearing God's word. They get excited. They get pumped up. They get fired up. But again, there's no root. They have not really thought through. They've never really thought it out as far as the implications of what they're hearing. This is the warm and fuzzy kind of person who is emotionally charged up and sheds tears and is greatly moved, but there's no real change. They have information, they have animation, but there's no transformation. Like a Roman candle, they burn out only after a short time. What happened? Why? Well, Jesus explains here that when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he or she falls away. Great interest, huge zeal, but the trials and troubles that come along reveal their lack of faith. They basically had the attitude, I didn't sign up for this, and so they quit. They react emotionally at first, but they have no genuine repentance of sin. The enthusiasm of the flesh robs them of true faith and joy in the Spirit. And the demands and responsibility of what it really means to be a follower, what it really means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, is quickly snuffed out in the emotional flames until all that's really left are dying embers. These people prove that they were never really saved to begin with. Now, how do we know that? They have no root. And so they bore no fruit. Tragically, I think it is that these two kinds of people, these first two kinds, the hard heart and the shallow heart, are lost. Now we're going to pick it up here in verse 22 with the third kind of person, and it's a third kind of soil. And it's the overcrowded heart. Verse 22, Jesus says, "And the one with whom, on whom seed was sown among the thorns, this is the man who hears the word, and the worry of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful." This group of folks is interesting. I want you to notice here that unlike the first two kinds of people, this seed actually produced a root, but there's no fruit. Why? Because these are the preoccupied people. You know people like this. This third kind of soil really represents the cluttered life. It's a life filled with the thorns that ensnare and strangle the faith and joy right out of that person. In fact, what we discover here are two thorns. These are the two major thorns that every single believer struggles with and has to be pulled out of the field of their hearts and lives. If you've ever struggled with abiding in Christ, if you've ever struggled with bearing fruit in your life, it's going to be because of one or both of these thorns in your life. And these two thorns are always growing continually and aggressively, like weeds, trying to choke the word of God right out of our hearts and out of our lives. Listen, these are the two thorns that will rip us off and rob us of our faith and joy every single time. What are they? They are the worry of the world and the seduction of riches. Two major thorns. Let's take a look at the first one. The first one is the worries of the world. The English word for worry literally means to choke. It has the idea of mental strangulation. Worry has a way of starving us of our faith and joy. It was Ruth Graham who once pointed out, "Worship and worry cannot live in the same heart." They are mutually exclusive. I agree. In other words, we cannot worship and trust and obey God and then worry at the same time. It's absolutely impossible. Can't do it. There's a second kind of thorn that Jesus mentions here in our parable, and it's the seduction of riches. This is the weed that preoccupies itself with the pursuit of money. 1 Timothy 6:10 warns us, "For the love of money is a root of all sorts of evil, and some by longing for it have wandered away from the faith and have pierced themselves with many a pang." It's not money. It's the love of money that is the root of all sorts of evil. And by the way, you don't have to be rich to love money. In fact, whether a person is rich, poor, or somewhere in between, this is the all-consuming passion, a virus that can infect and infest every single one of us. If only I had more money, if I only had more money, I'd be more happy. All my problems would be solved. And that's the seduction, the lies of riches. Billionaire J. Paul Getty was once asked this question by a reporter. Reporter asked J. Paul Getty, one of the wealthiest men in the world, he was asked, "How much money is enough? How much money is enough?" And he answered, "Always a little bit more. Always a little bit more." The seduction of riches has to do with the lust for more stuff. It's the allure of materialism. Someone refers to it as the disease of discontent. We're never satisfied. Worry and materialistic ambition are basically great thorn fertilizers. They're the two thorns that choke out our hunger and our thirst for the things of God. And so we have the hard heart, we have the shallow heart, we have the overcrowded heart, and then finally we have the fourth soil, and it's the good heart in verse 23. Jesus says, "And the one on whom seed was sown on the good soil, this is the man who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and brings forth some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. This is the person who welcomes the word implanted in his heart. He or she has a genuine hunger and thirst for righteousness. This is the heart that is open, it's willing to learn, it's prepared to hear. He is never too proud or too busy to listen to the truth. He understands. She's thought it out and is prepared to accept it and live it out. He translates what he hears into action. In other words, he applies the truth of what he hears into his life. And as a branch who abides in the vine, he bears much fruit in his life. Okay, so what can we take away this morning as we look at this parable? If there's one thing that this parable tells us, it's the fact that there will be widespread rejection. In other words, the majority of people reject the truth of God. That's the way it's always been. In fact, I want you to notice here that three-fourths of the soil in this parable does not produce any growth at all. Three out of four. And so let's quickly focus on two principles of spiritual growth that we discover here in our passage. First of all, sowing is widespread. The picture here is of a sower tossing the seed far and wide over all different kinds of soil. In other words, the gospel is to be preached everywhere, anywhere, regardless of the response. In Mark chapter 16, verse 15, Jesus tells us, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." You know, I think our natural tendency, at least mine is oftentimes, is to focus our time, to focus our resources on those people that are the most responsive, both in our personal lives and throughout the world. But you know, as theologian John Stott rightly points out, he says, our only responsibility is to preach and teach the gospel to everyone and to leave the responsibility of the results to the work of the Holy Spirit. In other words, we cannot change people's hearts. Only God can change the heart. We cannot change our spouse. We cannot change our kids, our parents, our friends. All we're called to do is just sow the seed, plant the truth of God's word, and leave the harvest, leave the results to God himself. We respect the freedom of the hearer to be either open and responsive to the truth or closed and resistant. But I think we also need to realize, and we may never know the outcome of what it might be as we share the good news with anyone and everyone. Maybe you heard the story about a Sunday school teacher by the name of Mr. Kimball. In 1858, Mr. Kimball led a Boston shoe clerk to give his life to Christ. That shoe clerk was Dwight L. Moody, who would later become an internationally renowned evangelist. While holding a crusade in England in 1879, Moody awakened evangelistic zeal in the heart of Frederick B. Meyer, who pastored a small church. F.B. Meyer, while preaching in an American college campus, brought to Christ a student by the name of J. Wilbur Chapman. Chapman employed a former baseball player named Billy Sunday to do some evangelistic work. Billy Sunday, in turn, held a revival in Charlotte, North Carolina. A group of local men there were so enthusiastic afterwards that they planned another campaign, bringing the great evangelist Mordecai Ham to town to preach. In that revival, a young man by the name of Billy Graham heard the gospel and yielded his life to Christ. And the story goes on and on and on. But it all started with a Sunday school teacher by the name of Mr. Kimball. He had no idea of the harvest that would result because of planting that one seed in that one person. Listen, it takes a long time for an acorn to become an oak. And so it may take a while before the seed of the gospel germinates in the heart of a person. And the long-term effect of changed lives can be immeasurable. Listen, if you're a Sunday school teacher, for example, you never know the hundreds, even thousands of lives that that one kid may make. Sow the seed and leave the harvest to God. Second application this morning is realizing that thorns are deadly. Get rid of the thorns. The thorns that grow up in our lives are an ever-present danger to the growth and well-being of every believer. As we see here in our passage, they basically come in two varieties: the worries of the world and the seduction of riches. If you're to be honest, which of those thorns are evident in the field of your heart? What are you going to do about your soil? What do you discover here in this parable about those four types of soil? Well, we discover, first of all, the first two soils, the hard heart and the shallow heart, they need conversion. There's obviously no root here, no spiritual depth at all. The third soil needs confession and repentance and dealing with those thorns that choke out the life. The big question is this: are these people saved? Well, can you have root without fruit? To be honest, I don't really know. But God knows the heart. And if you fall into that category, admit it. Just say, hey, that's me. I need to deal with that. Begin to focus on each one of those thorns and pull them out of your lives one by one. This is where confession comes in. In his book, In the Grip of Grace, Max Lucado points out that confession does for the soul what preparing the land does for the field. Before the farmer sows the seed, he works the acreage, removing the rocks and pulling the stumps. He knows that seed grows better if the land is prepared. Confession is the act of inviting God to walk the acreage of our hearts. There's a rock of greed over there, Father. I can't budge it. And that tree of guilt near the fence, its roots are deep and long. And may I show you some dry soil, too crusty for seed. God's seed grows better if the soil of the heart is cleared. In response this morning, ask yourself, what is one thing I'd like to be different? I would really like to change in my own heart and life. I pointed out last week that reading more books and listening to more sermons and watching more Christian videos won't make those thorns go away. How do you really grow in the freedom that God wants us to have and to yield a bumper crop, as this parable points out? It's taking the truth that we hear from God's word and applying it to our lives, living it out in obedience, working it out in the daily grind of everyday life. It's choosing to change, and then asking God for his power to work in and through us to work out those changes. We can't do it on our own, but that's preparing the soil, and that takes discipline. 1 Timothy 4:7 states, discipline yourself for the purpose of godliness. For bodily discipline is only of little profit, but godliness is profitable for all things, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Let me review just a couple of suggestions I made last week about spiritual growth, spiritual goals that I would encourage you to undertake. First of all, read through the Bible this year. I encouraged our church a couple of months ago, and many people have taken up the challenge to read through God's word in the next year or two. Keep a regular devotional life that is warm with the Lord. Remember, it's a love relationship, a personal relationship that we have with Him. Maintain a prayer list. Accept the responsibility of keeping a regular appointment with God daily if possible, and then interceding or praying for the needs of others. That's how you prepare the soil. The good soil, Jesus tells us here, produces an amazing harvest, 100-fold. That's unheard of in the natural course of things. But it speaks of the tremendous potential of the work of God, who richly blesses those who receive the word implanted in their hearts. He produces in and through us beyond what we could ever ask or think. And it's all about application. It's all about obedience of God's word that really does produce that bumper crop. You see, the fruit of the Spirit only grows in the garden of obedience. What thorns do you need to pull this morning? Is it worry, anxiety? What are you overly concerned about this morning? People right now are worried about so many things. They're fearful. They're not sleeping at night. They're panicked about the future and about the situation that we find ourselves in today. But you know what? Let it go. 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your anxiety upon Him. Why? Because He cares for you. God's still in control. God is still sovereign. Isaiah 26:3 reminds us that the steadfast of mind you will keep in perfect peace. Why? Because He trusts in you. Do you have His peace? Do you understand and know His love and care? What about the love of money, that other root? Are you consumed with stuff? What do you need to understand as far as how its grip might be in your heart and life? Right now, so many people are hoarding, not just toilet paper, but their resources, their money. They're afraid about the future, and they're thinking, I gotta hang on to this stuff. And they're cultivating a heart that is really in love with money. Isaiah 41:10 is a command. The Lord says, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. What will you do to cultivate the good soil of your heart? Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word, just a reminder of our relationship with you and how easy it is for those thorns to grow in the soil of our heart. And I pray, Father, that you would help us to identify those things, Lord, that hinder and hurt our relationship with you. Help us, give us the power, give us the strength to deal with the worry that so easily creeps up in our lives, and also our concern, our love for money. Father, I just pray that you would help us to keep our eyes focused on you, to understand that our time is short here on this earth, no matter how many years we're here in view of eternity. Father, I just pray that you'd fill us with your Spirit. Father, help us to grow in you, to be all that you've called us to be, and to shine the light of Jesus to a dark and dying world in desperate need of a Savior. And so we just commit our hearts and lives to you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
And like a flood, His mercy. has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my share and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone.
Will be forever.